very important definition, study of the interaction between matter and electromagnetic radiation. Matter and electromagnetic radiation. See, it is very important when we are talking about spectroscopy, it can be synonymously called spectrophotometry. So whenever there is a photon, there is a light, that is known as electromagnetic radiation. Now how to define radiation? So radiation is the emission or transmission of energy in the form of waves. Waves meaning, like if you have this kind of structure, okay, this is waves. Now every waves is having two part. The upper part is known as crest and the lower part is known as trough. Okay, so this is in the wave, okay, and so what is radiation? Is the energy of transmission, energy or emission or transmission of energy in the form of waves or particles, because light can be envisaged as in wave or particle. That's why we have the wave particle duality, okay. So now radiation is the transmission, emission or transmission of the energy in the form of waves or particle through space or through a material or the medium, okay. So this can be passed through a space or passed through a medium. Then why it is known as electromagnetic radiation, okay. So electromagnetic radiation, because any charged body, if it is moving, okay, so any moving charged body behaves like magnet. That's why it is, you know, electron is moving, and that's why you call it as electromagnet or electromagnetic radiation. So the position of electromagnetic waves within the electromagnetic spectrum. So we have a spectrum which consists of electromagnetic waves, okay. This is, you know, entire spectrum we have, and the position of electromagnetic waves within the electromagnetic spectrum can be characterized by either its frequency of oscillation or its wavelength. So as we know, every waves is having energy, every light is having energy. So this energy can be written by this equation, Planck's equation. This is Planck's constant, and is the frequency. Now frequency, you can say within this distance the frequency is 2, okay. If I reduce the wavelength, this is your wavelength, the wavelength of light, okay. If I reduce the wavelength, like if I can make like this the light 1, 2, 3 and 4, if you see the orange light, it is having only 2 frequency, but the white color light is having 4 frequency. So that's why we have an equation C upon lambda. If you reduce the lambda, okay, so your this is the lambda is reducing, okay, the frequency is increasing, and when the frequency is increasing, also energy of light increase. So in electromagnetic waves carry energy and can impart those energy to the matter with which they interact. So that means these lights, whenever they strike to a matter, to a material, they impart their energy to those medium. So now in optics, there is one theory known as corpuscular theory. Corpuscular theory. What is that? Corpuscular theory states, photon states that the light is made up of small discrete particle called corpuscles, okay, which can be written as photon. So photon, so this is one photon, okay, so this is as a particle, and this is the concept as a wave. So this is known as wave particle duality concept. Now how to classify this electromagnetic radiation? is classified as per the wavelength. Now, this is the smallest wavelength. We are talking about this is entire wavelength, okay? And this is the bigger wavelength, okay? Big wavelength. So, normally, the gamma radiation, okay? Normally, it is around 1 picometer, the wavelength. So, that's why it is associated with the high energy. It can be act as an ionizing radiation, okay? This is an ionizing radiation. Okay? Now, after gamma, then you have an X-ray. You can find it out, X-ray, different type of range, soft X-ray, hard X-ray. But normally it is 10 picometer to 10 nanometer. So over here it is nanometers enter. This is picometer. Okay. Now, after X-ray, you have a good gap to have UV. UV normally starts with, you know, around 200 nanometer to 450 nanometer. This is your UV range. Below 200 UV we call that vacuum UV. Why that? Because in presence of oxygen, the less than 200 nanometer UV light, in presence of oxygen, what happens? Oxygen starts to absorb those radiation. So it can interfere our reading to quantify the concentration or whatever it is, I will tell you. So it is interfering the our process. So below 200 nanometer, atmospheric oxygens start to absorb UV. That's why you have to perform the UV under the vacuum to prevent this interference. So that's why it's known as vacuum UV. So after UV, you have up to 750. That's your visible light. Okay. So visible light up to 750. Then after 750, you have near IR. So now this IR range, you have one near IR which is around 0.8 micrometer, that is 800 nanometer, to around, of course, 2.5 micrometer. This is your near IR. Okay, near IR methods is very useful to, you know, quantify the moisture in the sample. Even it can be used to understand the dissolution process. I'll explain that. Now, for after that, very useful IR range is mid IR, which is very useful to identify the functional groups present in the molecule. So that is 2.5 micrometer to 25 micrometer. Okay, so this is very important one. Then after that, you have near IR, far IR range. It is almost coming to